Today we're going to be looking at the women's rights movement, the beginning of it in the United States in the Age of Reform, basically from about the 1830s or the 1850s or during the Age of Jackson. And so what we're going to look at is a little bit of the background to why women were having to fight for rights, and we're going to be looking at why women were motivated to fight for rights, particular around this time and within the context in which they did. So to get specific, we're going to be discussing the origins of the women's rights movement and how the movement organized around the issue of suffrage. So to do so, we're going to be looking at a little bit of background, particularly of where did attitudes towards women come from. So we'll briefly touch on that, looking at this long history of misogyny. We'll be looking at the Enlightenment and the revivalism and the social order or the Second Great Awakening. We'll be looking at women's spheres of influence within society. And we'll be looking at their role within abolitionism and how that influenced the women's rights movement. And then finally, we will get to women's suffrage. Now, we're just going to be looking at the beginning of women's suffrage movement, but do understand that it was a 72-year struggle. It went on from 1848 to, it's fixed, to 1920 with the 19th Amendment. So yeah, we're just going to be looking at, well, why did this even come about? Why was there a call for women to have suffrage in this country? Well, so if you don't know what suffrage is, we'll talk about that in just a little bit too. So it's particularly important to understand what this word misogyny means. It's a real important word. It's a word that's still prevalent today, unfortunately, attitudes towards women. But the word literally means hatred, miso, and then genie, women. So the hatred of women. So to trace these historical roots of misogyny, it's very constructive to go back way, 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 way back to Greco-Roman times, particularly ancient Greeks. Western civilization, and by virtue of Western civilization, the United States of America, is heavily influenced by the historical existence of ancient Greece. And Rome. Our political institutions are based on its history, our philosophical institutions, social institutions, and views on women are influenced by Greco-Roman philosophy. So, you know, it was the birthplace of democracy as well. So the ancient Greeks have a special place in the American culture and mindsets in our hearts, right? They also had particular views when it came to women that greatly influenced Western civilization. And as colonial America is developing and the early republic is developing, those influences are carrying on. So the function of women was to basically have children in ancient Greece, especially sons. Their philosophers had very specific attitudes towards women. So this incredibly influential philosopher, Aristotle, very famous student of Plato, who fancied himself as a scientist. Some people understand him as the world's real first scientist. But this was his view of women. Just as it sometimes happens that deformed offspring are produced by deformed parents, and sometimes not, so the offspring produced by females are sometimes female, sometimes not, but male. The reason is that the female is, as it were, a deformed male, and the menstrual discharge is semen, though in an impure condition. Example, it lacks one constitutive, and one only, the principle of soul. So historically speaking, and philosophically speaking, women for thousands of years within Western civilization have been understood as deformed men who lack souls. Ugh. And then looking at how women have been viewed within Western civilization's religion, Christianity, here we have the scene of Eden right before everything goes to hell, right? Right, the scene, everything is beautiful, everything is perfect. The animals hang out with each other in peace. They are naked before each other without shame. But look at what she's got there that she was given to by that sneaky snake. And so they eat the apple that they were told not to, influenced by this temptress woman here. And now they are cast out of the Garden of Eden, and it's all due to Eve and her silly little ways. Hey, how's it going? Hey, and then looking at Leviticus 21:9, and the daughter of any priest, if she profaneth herself by playing the whore, she profaneth her father. She shall be burnt with fire, right? And this has tragic results because during the medieval period, many, many women were burnt at the stake. And this carried on into the colonial period with the Salem witch trials. So again, this view of women as other, as to be viewed as suspicious. So this influence would carry on over throughout Western civilization. And so when we look at the revolutionary period, we can see it being expressed through an exchange of very important people during this time period, that is during the 1770s, Abigail Adams and John Adams. Now, John Adams would become the second president of the United States. He was heavily influential within the revolutionary period and is greatly responsible for the call for independence within of the United States from Great Britain. Now, Abigail Adams and John Adams had this very unique relationship during this time. By all accounts, it was a very respectful relationship, and it would have been a very strange relationship in many ways because John Adams relied on her counsel. She was his confidant. She was his chief advisor on political decisions. But on this particular issue here, we have Abigail Adams writing her husband that she has not seen for quite a long time, who's off fomenting revolution and about to declare independence. It's March 31st, 1776. She says, "I long to hear that you have declared an independency. And by the way, in the new code of laws, which I suppose it will be necessary for you to make, I desire you would remember the ladies and be more generous and favorable than your ancestors. Remember, all men would be tyrants if they could." And so John Adams writes back to her, back to his wife. He says, "As to your extraordinary codes of laws, I cannot but laugh. Ha 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 ha. We've been told that our struggle has loosened the bonds of government everywhere, that children have apprentices or disobedient, the schools and colleges were grown turbulent, that Indians slighted their guardians, and Negroes grew insolent to their masters." And, you know, basically he's saying, "And now you, honey, you know, take it down a step, pipe down. Us men have very important things to do." So moving into the age of Jackson, the 1830s, we're moving into this time period of the expansion of democracy, which and the influence that it's going to have on women's rights. And where a lot of this is coming from, ironically enough, since women's source of oppression, part of the source of oppression has been from Christianity. Christianity is actually going to become a motivator to fight for rights. So you have the Second Great Awakening occurring. I'm not going to go into too much details from this conversation about what it was, but it was a religious revival, lots of preachers and people gathering around and getting all juiced up on religion. And one of the things that that they were anticipating, people who were kind of wrapped up in the Second Great Awakening, they were anticipating the second coming of Christ. Right? And so with this newly established Democratic Republic within its second, third generation, and this idea that Christ was afoot at any moment, well, people now have agency to shape society in the way that they want to. And we can make this a proper and fitting place for the second coming of Christ. So goes the thinking. And so out of the Second Great Awakening and during the age of Jackson, you begin to see movements like the temperance movement spring up, which is calling for the abolition of alcohol. You're also going to have the asylum and the penal reform movement crop up. You're going to have the abolitionist movement, the women's rights movement, and the educational movement during this time. And the one at the center right here, abolitionism, is going to be probably the most powerful of these movements. And this is going to really push or give forth to the women's rights movement. And I'll explain how that comes about in just a little bit. But before I do, it's very important to understand what women's political rights were, which were basically nothing. They couldn't vote. They basically had the legal status of a minor today, right? Someone under 18 years old. When they were single, they could own property, but if they got married, they would be considered legally dead, meaning any property they brought to the marriage would become her husband's. And if they had children, those would become the custody of their husband if, for some reason, the marriage was to become dissolved, or if there was a divorce, in other words. They could not initiate divorce. They couldn't make wills. They couldn't sign a contract, bring suit in court without her husband's permission. Right. The other thing that's going on at this time is this thing called the separate spheres concept, or Republican motherhood, which evolved into the cult of domesticity. Just a little bit of background on this, but basically between the Revolutionary era and the age of Jackson, you have the First Industrial Revolution. And one of the consequences of this is that you have a lot of the things that women used to do, like making clothes, churning butter, tending to the animals, whatever the case is, that's slowly being handed over to the marketplace, where it's being mass produced to some extent. It's not a complete transformation at this time, but it's beginning to happen. And slowly what's beginning to happen is women, before the Industrial Revolution, had some sort of influence within the home. They could negotiate within the household. Now, this isn't to say that women had rights or power or anything like that, but they did have some sort of influence within the home because they were contributing to the economy of the home. Now, that's beginning to wane with the Industrial Revolution, and so women are now being assumed into the role of being basically there to be a refuge of the cruel world, because the men are the ones going out into the workforce, which is corrupting their Christian ethics, right? But luckily we have these morally uncorruptible beings at home, women, and so it's her job, her duty to make sure that the husband and the children get to church on time and to keep the home civilized. Right, so you have that going on as well. That's important to keep in mind within the context of the age of Jackson. Because many of the leaders of the women's rights movement who were heavily involved in the temperance movement and the abolitionist movement and the educational reform movements, are, and especially the abolitionist movement, are going to begin equating this newly established role of women that's pretty entrenched by the 1830s, as equal to slavery, right? So women are identifying with the rules of slavery. So it's motivating them to want to get rid of slavery. That is, to get rid of slavery will also open up the constrictions that are placed on women within their role within society. And no other person articulated this understanding of women's role within society during this time more clearly and more stridently than the very radical Susan B. Anthony. She was incredibly radical for her time, and I would argue she would be quite radical for our time as well. But she noticed on what marriage was basically equating for her, what she noticed was that the married woman and their legal status is what she looked at. So she asked, well, what is servitude? And she answers, the condition of a slave. Well, what is a slave? It's a person who is robbed of the proceeds of his labor, a person who is subject to the will of another. I submit the deprivation by law of ownership of one's own person, wages, property, children, and denial of rights as an individual to sue and be sued, to vote and to testify in the courts, is a condition of servitude most bitter and absolute, though under the sacred name of marriage. So pretty radical, strident view on the conditions of women once they were married. And so understand this attitude that women like Susan B. Anthony are beginning to examine, and coupled with their interest in abolishing slavery within the abolitionist movement, which Susan B. Anthony was heavily involved with. So in 1840, you had this huge conference, the World Anti-Slavery Convention in London convening. So abolitionists from the United States and England mainly are all converging to London to come up with strategy on how to defeat slavery. And these two people right here, Lucretia Mott and Elizabeth Cady Stanton, were going to this convention. They were very excited. They were going to figure out how to rid the world of this scourge of slavery. And so when they get there, they have the men there organizing this function meet the women at the foyer and say, hey, little ladies, why don't you guys wait out here in the foyer, have a seat, see the sights. And when we're done coming up with our brilliant strategies of how to defeat slavery, we'll come out and tell you about the highlights. This was a sucker punch, a slap in the face to these women, because it told them a lot. I mean, to be against slavery before the abolition of slavery during this time was an incredibly radical view. So these men represent the most liberal, the most radical segments of society during their time. And even still, despite their open-mindedness and their understanding of human rights, they still are subject to the constraints of misogyny within their treatment towards women, even women that they have passionate goals in common with. So in 1840, this happens to them. Lucretia Mott and Elizabeth Cady Stanton are pretty incensed by this, and they carefully plan and correspond with each other an event called the Seneca Falls Convention, where they unveil the Declaration of Sentiments in 1848. So Seneca Falls is in New York. About 300 people convene, mainly women, but there were some men. There were up to about 60 men at that time. So the significance of it is it launches the modern women's rights movement from this point forward, calling mainly for women's suffrage. and established the arguments and the programs of the women's rights movement for the remainder of the century. So through the rest of the 1800s and even into the 1900s, concluding up to 1920, when we finished the first phase of feminism. So what they called for were things like educational and professional opportunities, property rights outside, within the context of marriage, legal equality, repeal of laws awarding the father's custody of the children in cases of divorce, and last but not without controversy, suffrage rights. Let's make sure we all understand what suffrage actually means too, because this word's been thrown around quite a bit and it's usually mistaken for something that it's not. So let's take a look at this video real quick so we have a clear understanding of what it actually means.
I am Will Albino. I'm here at Padua Academy, and we're just going to walk around and see if we can talk to their fine young students, who, by the way, it's the National School of Excellence as specified by the U.S. Department of Education. And we're going to see if I can't get them to sign a little petition here to end women's suffrage. I was wondering if you could sign this petition to end women's suffrage. Sure, thanks. Ending women's suffrage. Putting a stop to this injustice.
Women's suffrage is really bad.
How you doing? Can I get you to sign a petition to end women's suffrage real quick? Just real quick, just on signature, yeah. That's another one against women's suffrage. And no, another signature real quick to end women's suffrage.
I mean, like for the most part, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I know, really. For the most part, but just...
No!
We want to, like, eliminate any remaining threat of women's suffrage.
There isn't one, though.
Okay. Yeah, so just sign it. That's all. Nothing big. Just signing a petition to end women's suffrage. To eliminate women's suffrage. You're voicing your support to end women's suffrage.
Your right to vote.
Thank you. Just here. Just sign this right here. Here, take this pencil and a sign.
So that video goes on from there, but I think you get the point, right? So suffrage rights is the right to vote. And this was the most controversial proposal in the Declaration of Sentiments, calling for the right to vote. Mainly not because that the people there disagreed with women having the right to vote. Then it's Elizabeth Cady Stanton who's pushing this. They were saying to her, Elizabeth, listen, we understand that this is an important part of women's rights, but if we push for it, people will think we're ridiculous, because it would be viewed back then as absolutely ridiculous that women had the right to vote. And we will lose these other things. Educational, professional opportunities, property rights, legal equality, divorce reform, and whatnot. And Elizabeth Cady Stanton simply argued, without the right to vote, how do you think you're going to get those things? Nobody's going to listen to us ever unless and until when we have the right to vote. So there was a lot of debate, and it was almost tabled. But this man was in attendance of the convention, Frederick Douglass, one of the most prominent abolitionists of his time, probably the most prominent runaway slave, self-educated, had tremendous respect within the abolitionist community. And remember, anyone involved in the women's rights movement was heavily involved in the abolitionist movement. And he stood up and argued basically that Elizabeth Cady Stanton was right. Women have to have the right to vote if they expect to get any of these other rights that they're calling for. And so it was called for, basically. And so 1848 officially kicks off the women's suffrage movement. Unfortunately, though, the women's suffrage movement is going to last 72 years. It's not going to conclude until we get to 1920, with the passage of the 19th Amendment. There's several reasons for that, including misogyny. There's a huge split within the movement. But for purposes for our discussion, it's just important to know it took a long time. But to just kind of recap, the women's suffrage movement is basically a very interesting pushback against long-standing attitudes towards women described as misogyny. It comes about through the Second Great Awakening, coupled with this democratic revolution that's happening within the age of Jackson, within American society in the 1820s, 1830s, 1840s. And women getting involved in things like the abolitionist movement are understanding that they have no power within that movement. So not even the men that agree with them even understand them to be fully competent human beings. And so the reasoning, the rationale to push for the right to vote, aside just from basic human rights concerns, is it's from a practical point of view. If we want respect in this society, we have to have access to suffrage. And so begins, again, this long, enduring movement that is a very interesting movement to study, and I would recommend watching a film called The Iron-Jawed Angels. Iron-Jawed Angels, which was produced by HBO, which covers the last 8 years of the women's suffrage movement, so the 1912 to about 1920. Okay, that's all I have for the beginning of the women's suffrage movement. Let me know if you have any questions.